Welcome to The Third Story. I'm Leo Sidran. Today's conversation features one of my favorite singers, Madeleine Peyroux. I remember the first time I heard her on a recording, she was singing Leonard Cohen's Dance Me to the End of Love. It was so elegant and so sophisticated, and it just stunned me. First of all, it was hard to tell if it was new or old, or both. She's got the kind of voice that pulls your ear and your heart about 100 years into the past. In fact, 100 years is a pretty apt number to use, since this week the world celebrated the 100th anniversary of the birth of another great American singer, Billie Holiday. And Billie's influence is certainly alive in Madeleine Peyroux. But there's also a somewhat more modern sensibility in her approach, definitely in the song choice. Throughout a career that began as a teenager singing on the street in Paris, Madeleine's allowed a wide range of musical material to move through her. Her life reads like a novel. She moved to Paris as a teenager, ran away and started singing on the streets and squatting in a boat on the Seine. Not long after that, she was discovered by a record executive who eventually signed her to a contract. But the whole ordeal was overwhelming, and despite the fact that they made a record, she disappeared again into the shadows. When she emerged a few years later, she had recorded a brilliant record called Careless Love, and the rest is either history or mystery. I met her a few times over the years, and even did a brief recording session with her in Brooklyn once. We'd been going back and forth for a couple of months trying to set something up for this interview, and ultimately the timing just wasn't working out. She wrote to me to say that she was going to be unavailable for a while because she was going to be in France. This is where the episode takes a bit of a turn. See, I was also planning to be in France during that same period. We compared our schedules and realized that we had one window of overlap in Paris. It was the day I was arriving. So just last week, I landed at Charles de Gaulle and went pretty much straight to a café in Montmartre that she had suggested. So picture it. We're sitting outside on the corner, just down from her mother's apartment, from the apartment that she lived in as a teenager, just as her life was unfolding. It's chilly outside, but it's pleasant. We find a table and order a drink, and as we talk, the cafe fills up and empties out again. People sit next to us. We order another drink. We move inside. We order fries. As the sun sets outside, the noise level rises inside. And throughout it all, Madeleine is immensely generous with her time and her candor. It's a pretty freewheeling conversation, very casual, and the sound of the recording puts you on the corner in Montmartre, right where we sat just over a week ago. Oh, and as soon as we sat down, we discovered that we actually live about a block away from each other in Brooklyn. Despite the fact that, as she says, it's very reliable to be unsatisfied, I am very satisfied with this episode, and I'm very happy to play it for you now. Don't forget you can subscribe to the podcast at third-story.com or on the iTunes Music Store. I tweet at Leo Sidran, and you can like the podcast on Facebook. It's The Third Story Conversations with Leo Sidran. Before we get started with the conversation, I want to play you that first song I heard her sing from the 2004 Careless Love album. Here's Madeleine Peyroux singing Dance Me to the End of Love.
Beauty with a burning violin. Dance me through the panic till I'm gathered safely in. Lift me like an olive branch and be my homeward dove. Dance me to the end of love. Dance me to the end. Beauty when the witnesses are gone. Let me feel you moving like they do in Babylon. Show me slowly what I only know the limits of. Dance me to the end of love. Dance me to the end. Very long. We're both of us been dance me to the end of love. Dance me to the end of love.
You know, the stories of people that nobody ever gets to hear.
Yeah. Well, here we are. I don't. Then why are you asking me to do one, right?
You know what? You know what, though? Honestly, I think that you are a bit of a mystery. I mean, I think people know who you are, but I think that you personally are a little bit of a mystery.
Well, listen, you can't get any closer than this. We're at the square of, like, five streets, right, in Montmartre. My mother's apartment is right there. I'm 40 years old now, but, like, this is the same old Paris, almost. I mean, of course, some things have definitely changed, but you know, I'm probably the same person like I was when I first started playing music. It was because of this city. So I kind of want to milk that when I talk to you right now, because
I mean, I have to tell
like
you,
so
I think
ironic.
It is such a gift to get to sit here with you on this corner. Because everything that I do know about your sort of creation musical story starts here.
With including all the noise that you don't want to hear. That's part of the story.
I don't know. In Paris, the noise is music, too, I guess.
Yeah, those engines are really obnoxious, you know. Like, this is a good example of a place where it looks like a fun place to go and play for people. Because you've got what we call the captive audience, mm-hmm. You know. We've got the terraces out here. But because of the cars, it wouldn't work. It's just too much.
So how do you feel when you come back here? Do you feel like you go back to that headspace that you were in when you lived here as a teenager?
Well, there's sort of two sides to it. My headspace as a teenager at the time was based on rebellion and freedom, and I wanted to be, able to do anything I wanted to do. And just be completely free. I mean, being out in the street with my guitar, with a goal, like kind of a musical goal, basically, which was I want to get good enough to play the guitar to play songs that I like to sing already, that I already know, and then become self-sufficient. And seeing all these musicians around in the Latin Quarter, that was the goal. So, but yeah, I do come back here and I kind of realize... Well, to be honest, I feel like I haven't grown up at all, and it's a little depressing, you know? That's how it feels emotionally, you know, which I probably haven't. But, you know, yeah, I've learned to be a little bit more professional, like being on time, except not with you today, but...
How old were you when you moved to Paris?
Okay, I was 13, and we actually didn't move into the city. We moved to a suburb.
Uh-huh.
And I went to an international high school and took classes in both languages, English and French for a year and a few. And then I was about to get kicked out, and I was sent to boarding school in England, and I ran away from that, and I caused all kinds of hell for my mom. And so in January of 1990, I've just been recently figuring this stuff out, I moved to Paris. So I was 15, yeah.
And through all of that turmoil before you moved to Paris, were you singing?
I was singing at home. My mother had given me a guitar the year I got to France when I was 13. And I had songbooks, and I had some records that I loved. And I had apparently even sat in, like, the metro sometimes. Like, if I would go on a trip into Paris with my guitar, and if I hadn't finished what I was working on, I would just sit in the station and try and play it some more. And then one day somebody threw me a coin.
Mm.
I was like, what is that? So then when we moved to Paris, I saw street musicians like everywhere. And that was the end of that, or the beginning of that.
And what were you listening to?
Paul Simon's Graceland, Peter Gabriel. So I was listening to... Graceland had just come out. I liked Tracy Chapman. I liked Paul Simon. Other than that, I was listening to 70s music constantly. And, you know, early swing, like Fats Waller and all that stuff, that had kind of already been part of our lives because my parents had that around all the time. Robert Johnson and Hank Williams and Fats Waller, and of course Louis Armstrong, etc.
So you didn't even necessarily feel like you had to find that. That found you already. That was already in you.
Yeah, actually, that's kind of why I think it was easy for me to jump into playing in the street, because a lot of the musicians here were playing that kind of music. And I mean, there was a guitarist who used to sort of fake the lyrics to stuff, but he was a really good rhythm guitar player. And he would just, he had this great energy. He was actually from the Bronx. And his name's Bad Boy Billy. He called himself Bad Boy Billy from the Bronx. It was just Billy. And he had a great sound and a great rhythm playing. But then he would just say, and I'd be like, that's not exactly. So I went up to him and I said, you know, your feet's too big. Actually goes like this, like the lyrics are a little different, and isn't that cool? And he looked at me like, sort of like he half didn't care, but also was like, oh, I'm impressed with that, you actually know the song, because I actually just knew the lyrics.
And you were kind of a kid.
Yeah.
Which is probably kind of impressive
15,
too.
Yeah. You know. Yeah, I mean, that's a question mark for me in France, in Paris. How much of this has to do with how old you are? Obviously, in the arts in general, it has an effect on your identity. But in the sort of atmosphere of being on the street, you know, I think it's almost not as surprising, because mm-hmm. that's when teenagers, that's what they like to do. So they end up being out there, and then, you know, there are some people that are welcoming towards you. There's not a lot of ageism at that place. And besides, nobody's really trying to make a career or make a big statement, you know.
That's what I think is so interesting about the story, actually, is that, you know, you have a career, kind of an old school career. Like, you basically just went out on the street and started singing, and ironically, you have the career.
Yeah, yeah, it's pretty, I find it ironic, too. I mean, there's a lot of craziness in terms of how money works, right? And you're talking kind of more about money and career and timing, obviously,
right.
And luck. And it's true that when this guy, Yves Beauvais, approached me, first of all, you know, nobody really cared if he wanted to make a record, because it was at a time in the mid-90s where they were still making money.
Mm-hmm.
And if some guy who oversees jazz projects wants to make a little record, I mean, it's like, sure, go ahead, but nobody really cares and nobody expects anything. And if the record gets some recognition, then it's like, oh my God, what in the world is happening? But because of that first experience, I've just kept, you know, and then I kind of was thrust into doing what they expect you to do in that situation, which is, I don't know, spend several days doing interviews or get yourself a band, you know.
Right.
Be a band leader, get on a plane every day or something like that. It's kind of a big difference between, oh, I like to sing.
Right. Exactly.
But once I got through all that stuff, you know, I didn't like it at first. But I also tried other things, and then I couldn't do anything else.
Like what?
Well, I didn't try to do anything really, but I just started by just wanting to get a regular job, and I couldn't make enough money to survive, which is probably still true for most people. Waiting tables, teaching preschool. Of course, I don't have a degree or anything, so it's not like I had a real idea of what I was going to do, but you couldn't survive. It costs more money to work than it does to do nothing, you know? And then I ended up seeing a place where they wanted somebody to come in and sing at this club, and I was like, okay, do that. And sure enough, I thought I could just live on that.
Yeah,
it became more regular and more reliable than pretty much anything else in my life. So I don't understand that at all, because it's not what people expect from music. But yeah, I guess there's a momentum to be had, and there's the fact that I was really lucky, because I was there in the mid-90s when record companies really did still have money, and they had money to spare for small-time acts. And I'm still kind of a small-time act, that's the thing, but I just managed, because I got some establishment, then, you know, it can keep me going. At least for touring, you know.
Right.
What do you tell people now?
Well,
I don't know.
Don't expect a record deal is all. You know, don't even think that that's the utmost thing that you could have, because it's not, you know. Like, because in the end, even if you don't think of it in a financial way, you think of it in an artistic way. You say, well, what is a record? Like, I always thought that was strange in the mid-90s. Oh, we're going to make a... What are we doing? We're going to make a record. What's a record? Like, yeah, I've listened to records, but that doesn't mean I know what that means.
But you kind of emerged, it seemed to me, pretty fully formed in terms of a voice. You know, what do you make of that? That you sort of... I've seen video of you on the street in Paris, and it's there.
Well, yeah, that's a mistaken... That's a problem, because it wasn't there. It was, but you know, here's the way it worked. I could somehow do a really good performance if I felt like it. It doesn't, but that's not what is demanded in the career that I have.
Right.
What's demanded is do a really good performance when you promised that you would, when you signed a contract saying that day you were going to do a really good performance. It's a really big difference, and that's the downside to having had the good life of playing music on the street, because the whole idea is freedom. And on one hand, it's extremely inspiring, and obviously it's freeing from any kind of like rules of society. Like, no, we didn't have bank accounts, and we didn't have telephones, or you know, we didn't have email accounts. We didn't have to answer to anybody. After a few days, if Danny said, hey, you know, let's get out of here, we'd drive, we'd get in the car. But it was like freedom to the extent where, I mean, nobody paid rent. We lived on a boat, and for some reason they didn't know we were there. Like, we didn't pay rent at the time. And all of a sudden, like 10 years later, they came around and they were like, you guys haven't been paying us rent. You've got this boat double parked next to, you know, their paniches, their barges in this neighborhood where they're all barges.
So you left home to do this.
Oh, you're going to make it sound like that. Yes, you're right to ask that question, of course. I did. I really did. There was a point where I was in a high school, and it was maybe the fourth or fifth high school that I had, you know, either applied or gone to for a short while, that finally, the first one that finally said, okay, you say you have this gig, you say you want to go off and do this gig and everything, we'll work with you so that you can catch up on your homework. And I was like, nah, I already made up my mind.
I'm done.
Can't do both, yeah. That's it. So, I don't know, maybe my thinking was I can always go back and study American history, which I did. I went and got my GED, you know. But I don't know that I'll always be able to just do this, what we're doing, and learn these songs this way. And to be honest, I was aware of the fact that studying music in a school, I would never get in. Like, I wasn't good enough. I had no special talent at all. In fact, even in elementary school, I was heartbroken. They would never give me a solo because I was an alto, and I was really pissed off. At the chorus director, they wouldn't give me a solo song. And then one day they had an event where they were doing a chorus. They were doing a concert for New York City. If you could come up with a song about New York City, you could sing the solo. And I did all this research, and I got this song together that like nobody's ever really heard. It was from some old Broadway musical. Take me back to Manhattan, that dear old dirty town. Some old silly Broadway musical. I'll take me back to Manhattan. And I studied it, and I had the sheet music and everything. And then I got chicken pox on the day of the show. So I never had my chance to shine. And that was in, you know, elementary school. And back then, you know, Brooklyn. I mean, I was in Brooklyn. All the greatest schools are right there. And that's part of the problem. Like, how many people can actually get into one of those schools? Whether you're from New York or not, actually. But coming to Paris, first of all, I was automatically different. So that was actually a good thing.
Yeah.
And second of all, people respect musicians over here, you know?
Totally.
I'm not the first one to say that at all, so...
You know, I've been thinking a lot about the difference between singers. This is going to sound like a terrible setup.
I
want to
hear this. Yeah, I love
difference
that.
Between singers and
everybody else.
I was going to say musicians, but I think everybody else is actually
that's
a good
fair.
Way to say it. You know, there is a distinction, and I think a lot of times, especially in the sort of jazz world, singers and instrumentalists can sometimes be dealing with those differences.
Mm-hmm.
But the truth is that when I hear you talk about all of this, it really does make me realize that in order to find your artistic voice, your point of view, your music, and above all, to be able to tell a story, you kind of had to live through some shit. You describe basically a certain amount of alienation, both in Brooklyn and in Paris.
Yeah.
And I think that by the time you deliver a lyric that maybe was written by an older person a long time prior to you, probably a man, you actually could relate to some of what was going on in the lyric, whereas probably a lot of 15-year-old girls wouldn't be able to look into what those songs were really saying.
Right. I mean, I do think, obviously, that the lyrics, and the lyrics are very important to me, always have been, but I do think that being able to sing tragic songs was part of the, attraction. Before I got to Paris, you know, I lived in an alcoholic home and in a violent home, and it was just crazy. And the reason we moved to Paris was that my parents finally divorced. You know, that's the way I felt about it then. And I was like, thank God. I mean, it wasn't easy. You know, I'm not going to lie. It wasn't like, oh, everything's cool now. But, you know, and then after that finally happened, then it was like, okay, now we start our regular lives. What do we do first? And my mother got a job offer. And this was her dream. So it was part of her way of starting over. Which wasn't easy for us, but, you know, I had a lot. That's, you know, you listen to Billie Holiday's voice and you go, yeah, man. And of course she just cuts through anything. And that's one of the ways I would describe her genius. She could just cut through anything. I mean, to be able to create sound. And by the way, isn't the human voice this is how singers are different from everybody else. We think we're the most amazing thing that's ever come to earth. And why do we think that? Well, obviously, because, you know, we're not always correct in thinking that. But however, the human voice is really the most versatile, weirdest, most personal, most individual thing there is. Because nobody, it's like fingerprints.
Yes.
Nobody has the same one. And you can always tell something from the sound of somebody's voice. You already have emotive expression. You don't already have that with a... In fact, that's the whole problem with musicians. That's the hard part. That's how you struggle to be a musician, isn't it? Or it is for me, because I can't do it, you know?
I mean, I think people can... Obviously, there, over the years, have been some wonderful stylists who have been able to break your heart with their sound. But you're right, it's a different... But I know exactly what you're saying.
No, and I'm not saying that there wasn't. I'm saying, on the contrary, that's the goal, though.
Yes.
That's one of the barriers for an instrument. Whereas with the human voice, you don't have that barrier. You're not struggling with that in the sense that there might not be the right emotion, or it might not be what you wanted, but there's always something. There's always some emotion coming through.
Do you feel more exposed on stage in front of an audience? Because I think you're right that you share, you know, you're really laying out a lot of emotion. And you said before, I was always able to give a good performance when I was ready to give a good performance,
but
when
I mean,
wanted to.
I wasn't, but that's not, that doesn't mean it was often, you know.
Right.
It could be like, I mean, I do remember a few moments where I was like, okay, now I'm going to go do this song, and come hell or high water, they're going to let me do it the way I want to do it, and it's going to come across the way I want it to come across. But that was rare, you know, and that's just a sort of feeling and embodiment of what it is that you see in something.
How have you learned to deal with that as a professional?
That's hard. I mean, I have to say, I think I've probably given so many bad shows ever since they gave me this career that, you know, it's pretty much should be over by now. Definitely. We'll see. We'll see what happens tomorrow.
Wait, why do you say that?
It doesn't really work. I mean, yeah, of course, I still love to sing, and I still always feel great some of every show. But to have like a really great show from beginning to end and still be, and not to be so scripted and not to be, to keep that spontaneity. Even the greatest artists, I'm sure, get tired, you know? And that's like a huge issue for this idea of how the audiences think of us. I mean, that's tiring.
That's very tiring.
That sound is tiring.
Right, that's an issue, to be able to go and deliver.
Well, to grow up, you know, or to change, or to, yeah, to deliver something with the same attitude. And then there's, of course, you know, just the idea that maybe your attitude is just not what people want to hear right now, and that's another problem entirely.
Do you feel that as you get older and you become an adult, that you've become an adult, that, like, you know, you were so young when you started, and that was part of what people were impressed by, was that you had this old soul and this older voice.
Yeah.
And you were younger. I mean,
it's not going to be that special anymore, right?
No, it's a good question. I mean, I know that at that age, there's a shorter distance between what you sing and this very sort of pure emotion, just blasting out, like, I'm angry, you know. Like, one of my favorite examples of that is hearing Dylan just, you know, just banging it out on an acoustic guitar. And he's not screaming, but you can tell that it's just pure anger from beginning to end of the song. And he actually had a bunch of songs like that. And apparently I was really, really attracted to that back then. And I'm 40, and for some reason this year I'm starting to go a little softer on that. Like, it's not as interesting to me anymore. It shouldn't matter. You know, I remember a lot of people saying, oh, you know, this is when people do their best work. Up until the age of like 30 or something like that. Trumpet players. And I mean, even musicians saying that. That's just like a given. Like, you're never going to get past that.
But then there's a whole other school of thought that says, especially if you're thinking in terms of jazz, that as you get older, you become more refined. You know, that your voice can be distilled down to its most essential thing. You know, you listen to old soloists, and they might be playing, you know, one chorus of something, and it just kills you. You know?
Yeah, and it's not only for jazz, but I think jazz is a really good example, because it's still a very demanding thing, and it's dexterity, and it's not, you can't really just get away with riffs and stuff. I do think it's possible. I just don't know how it's done yet. I mean,
but do you feel like you're burning out?
Well, no, but I did take a break since last summer. I haven't been on the road very much. I've done some things, but I haven't been constantly touring.
And that was intentional?
Kind of, yeah, but not even for a specific reason. I didn't actually feel like, oh, I'm burnt out. I was so burnt out that I didn't even feel burnt out. Like, I was just like, I just got to stop right now.
Yeah.
And I didn't even feel the need to, you know, I was just not able to feel anything for a little while. I think it's a bad thing to get burnt out, I guess. But on the other hand, it's sort of like, well, who doesn't get burnt out on their job?
Yeah.
Because it's a job.
You mentioned...
I'm not saying anything.
You're killing
right
me.
Now.
Everything you're saying is so perfect.
Yeah, right.
You know it.
Very good, yeah. Yeah, let's go back to why singers... I never answered that. What did you say? Why are singers different? And I said, well, because they're awesome. No, it's all right. I answered that.
You totally answered that. What you did say, though, is that Billie Holiday cuts through. I don't know if I've ever heard you deal with that comparison. I mean, you must have dealt with it a million times, but like when I asked you what you were listening to,
it wasn't her.
And you had all this deep older music that was kind of in your early DNA from growing up, and then you were listening to Peter Gabriel and you were listening to more contemporary music. But where did the Billie thing come from?
Billie was somewhere in my consciousness somewhere, but it was when I started working with this guy, a bad boy Billy from the Bronx, and I told him, hey, you know, you don't know the lyrics to the Fats Waller song and everything, and I started working with him, and he was studying the early Columbia recordings, and he was checking out the Lester Young solos, trying to pick them up on guitar. He thought that would be a way for him to get riffs and stuff for arranging on guitar. So he was listening to them over and over again, and I would hear a song and I'd be like, that's cool, I could maybe do that, because it's her. It was because it was her, I'd be like,
it's not so impossible. I can hear what the song's about, and of course the range is not huge. She would change melodies and everything, and it would be, in fact, she would take really mediocre type songs that didn't really mean a lot, and she would twist them just a little bit, and you'd be like, yeah, it's meaningful, mm-hmm. you know, and it's just enough. And that's when it happened, and I just spent months with him. I spent an entire summer with him, and then after that I left school, and then I really, by then I had a few songs, and I joined this band and left school, and, you know.
And this is the band that was playing on the streets here.
Yeah.
How did you get back to New York?
First of all, I left the band and tried playing in the subways by myself for a while, and I had gotten better at playing guitar because of them, and learned a lot of new songs. But I was living on the street for too long. I started losing my mind.
What do you mean?
Well, I was just not able to talk for a while. I became, like, really weird, you know. I would go sing at this club, but I guess I drank too much for a while. I had a really weird experience when I was 18.
And this is here, or you're in New York now?
Well, my mother took me back to the States to go visit my grandfather, and we were going to fly to New York and go to Virginia. And instead of going to Virginia, I ended up in a mental hospital in New York for 3 months. I was 18. After that, I came back to France for a while. But right after getting out of the hospital, I got a phone call from this guy who'd seen me with the street band from Atlantic Records. And he said, come and make a demo with me. So a few years later, I signed a record deal with him.
When you say that you couldn't talk, could you still sing during that period? That when you weren't able to talk, or you couldn't express
anything?
Yeah, I could
sing, yeah.
You could sing, but you couldn't talk.
I couldn't talk.
What did it feel like when you would open your mouth to sing? Did you feel like you were able to express something that you weren't able to express when you were talking or trying to talk?
Yeah, I think you always can. I mean, you know that there must be the same thing for you and with your instrument, right?
Yeah, I think it's another language. I mean, I think music is an alternate language. But what's interesting to me, and this goes back to the difference between singers and non-singers, is that it's easier to draw a distinction between the two when it's not actually coming out of the same hole in your face. You know what I mean? Like, the same, you're speaking words or you're singing words, but there's a distinction.
I would think it would be less satisfying if it weren't the same hole in your face. You know, it's less satisfying because it's less obvious that it's you. I love the fact that there's a place to express what we normally can't. And music must be like the closest thing to really being direct that there is on the planet. No messing around. I don't think you meet a lot of musicians that feel like they've never gotten to say anything.
Right.
Heard. Like, I never, nobody heard what I had to say. Nobody understands me. Yeah, maybe, like, I didn't get fame, but it's not in conversation. No.
When you got your Atlantic deal and you made that first record.
Yeah.
What was the experience of making that record and the sort of,
oh, that was just weird. Well, I went back to being a little bit catatonic, not in a like in a bad way, but like I really wouldn't talk to anybody because I was, first of all, I was just in awe of the musicians around me. I mean, the guys he pulled together for the first session were Mark Rebo, Kenny Wallace, and Greg Cohen, Charlie Giordano on keys. Regina Carter came in. James Carter did some overdubs. Then we did a couple of more tracks with Cyrus Chestnut, Leon Parker, even Vernon Reed was there. I don't know why that happened, but, you know, it was hilarious. But
so what did you feel? Obviously, you say you felt a little bit overwhelmed by it.
Just in awe of the whole process and like, wow, what are we doing? I mean, I didn't think it was very good. That's how I'm always that way, though, because if somebody likes something, it's usually when I don't think it's any good. I'm like, nah, I don't like that. So, I don't know if I've... Do you want the same thing?
Yeah, I'll have the same thing.
Just a second.
Yes.
What,
I don't know. Yeah.
Why do you think that is?
Well, maybe it just has something to do with relying on self-criticism, you know, to get to the point where it's a viable, you know, expression of something, but still being unsatisfied, that's sort of also reliable, I think.
You feel like by being dissatisfied or never really satisfied, it keeps you striving for something better?
Well, I think it's a habit. It's not a conscious sort of decision, but I think it's a bad habit. You know, it might have something to do with being self-taught, living in one's own mind. I read a book about kids that are really advanced because my father was kind of that way. Like, he could do stuff really, really young in a literary sense. He was really into... He could just read, like, right off the bat. He could just read. Hmm. And he was a tortured soul, you know? And so I read this book about that, and it's called The Drama of the Gifted Child. It came out, I think, in the 60s or something like that. And it's sort of trying to understand that sometimes if you're in your own world, whether it's because you're self-taught or because you're advanced in something, you tend to never be satisfied with what you've got. And it makes sense to not be satisfied because you don't have somebody to play off of and say, well, where does it end? Where is it actually worth sharing with the rest of the world? What's the goal here?
Mm-hmm.
And there are different kinds of perfection, too. And, like, where do we even... Where's the context?
How do you use dissatisfaction?
Mm-hmm.
And you connect it to your father in some way.
He's somebody that definitely never finished anything, and he was very proud in his presentation, you know, in the way that he presented himself to the world. But he must have been very self-deprecatory and very, you know, insecure on the inside.
But you don't have, after that your parents separated, you don't have much memory of him or a relationship with him, or you do?
I did. I mean, sort of on and off. I mean, my years in Paris, I didn't have any relationship with him. But then I know we went to New York with the band, which is where the guy from the record saw me. And he came in and he was just like, oh my God, you're singing these old blues songs. This is fantastic.
You said this thing about how generally if people dig something that you do, your first impulse is to say... I heard it in two ways. Either if somebody says they dig it, your first impulse is to say, no, it's not, I don't think it's good enough. Or I also heard you say a lot of the stuff that other people like that you do is the stuff that you're more critical of yourself.
Yeah, it's more the latter.
Yeah.
I think when somebody else likes something, I take a second look at it and go, huh, oh. But, you know, that's why I end up asking people for advice before anything's finished, because I don't want to even bother with something that's no good.
But, you know, you also said, again, you know, when I said, what were you listening to? The stuff that you were listening to was contemporary. Let's say, like, when you were 15 years old. It was contemporary. But you had, despite whatever you had found on your own, you had this base of music that was very automatic for you.
Yeah.
And when you got on the street, it turns out that that became, like, this really useful thing to you.
Yeah.
Even though it wasn't anything that you were, like, searching for consciously or working towards, it was just something that kind of came out of you because it had been placed there already.
No, absolutely. Yeah.
And you know, I could see how that could even be a little bit confusing, because it's like, well, this isn't even what I was trying to do. This isn't even necessarily the music that I was thinking of making or the songs that I was thinking of singing. I was thinking of singing this kind of thing. And then I ran into these dudes on the street, and it turns out, like, I just knew this music that they didn't really know.
Well, I mean, I think in between all of that, at that point, I didn't necessarily have, like, a desire of a style of music I wanted to sing. What I really wanted to do is understand chords and harmonies. Like, I mean, I remember picking up these Beatles books, and you know how, like, if you get fake books, you go, well, that doesn't sound exactly like it was,
yeah.
But it kind of passes, and you're like, well, what should I be doing now? I'm trying to learn to play this chord, but I also really want to hear this other harmony. And, like, so that was what was perturbing me. I was just disturbed by the idea that I needed to understand, what is that sound? What is that chord? What is that harmony? And if early jazz, what better place to go? It's like, that's it. That's the key. Because it's just a little bit, you know, simplified and spelled out more than later jazz, but it has all of the ingredients, you know, 30s, 40s. It has all of the chordal sort of things that you need to hear, I guess.
Unless
you're gonna, you could look at other music probably and say, you could have, you know, check out Chopin or Bach or something. But this, for me, it all made sense.
I mean, over and over again, I hear you saying the goal was, I want to learn these songs. I want to hear this sound. I want to figure this out. I just want to sing. And like, so at some point, somebody throws a quarter at you while you're playing guitar, and you go, wait a minute.
I can do this.
I can do this.
For a living.
But what was the effect of actually finding success? Do you feel like you've been successful as an artist?
No.
Do you feel ambitious?
I don't think so. I mean, but for what? What's the point? What, I mean, what else is there? Industry folks behind the scenes would have said to me on a couple of occasions, you know, you could really push this more. You could really, like, take it to the next level. All these vague terms, you know. And then I'd be like, yeah, great, let's do it, you know. And a few months later, I'd be like, well, so what happened to that guy? Well, he didn't feel like he really wanted that. And I'm like, well, what didn't I do? You know, well, I don't know, you didn't. Throw yourself into an itinerary of dumb type of promotional things, I guess. And I guess that's, I don't even know.
So when I asked you, do you feel like a success as an artist, you said no.
And maybe this goes back to, like, not being satisfied, you know? I don't know. I think, yeah. No, but that's a different question entirely, right, from the career, right?
Yeah.
You want to say, well, have I done anything? Have I said anything new? And, I mean, I won't say that I'm not proud of... It's hard for me to think of the records as being able to stand on their own. I think of the records as, you know, a part of what I do live. Maybe that's part of the reason that those records are still not up to par, because if they could really just stand on their own and I would never need to sing again, that would be great. On the other hand, that would be a terrible business plan, because you don't make money selling records. And
I'm not hearing you thinking about business at all. I'm not hearing that as a factor in your thinking at all.
No, I would really like to think that I could walk away from any gigs tomorrow, except I'd piss so many people off. But, I mean, I wouldn't have a problem living financially, because I don't need a lot of things. Although, you know, it's easy to say that, so, because I don't have kids. So.
What you're thinking about is not necessarily the sort of, like, the questions of commerce.
Well, it's not about money.
Yeah.
I mean, of course it's about money. Everything's about money. If you're willing to say that money is just a tool for looking at value systems, and you're willing to look around and say, all right, we're all part of this shit. I mean, this is Paris. I mean, who am I kidding?
You know?
My mother's got an apartment upstairs. You know, everything's about money, and I live in Park Slope. I mean, forget about it. But at the same time, because it's just a tool, because it doesn't really represent anything specific at all, and in a really higher sense, it's just like a hammer. You know, it's just something that you have if you need it. And and then you just try to figure out, you know, how often are you going to need to use the hammer? Something like that. It's a really bad metaphor.
I like the idea of money as a hammer. Because, you know, money is a tool. People say money is a tool.
Yeah.
So you choose your tool. You chose hammer.
Yeah. I should have said something better, like scissors, you know, or something, because it's more versatile. I think I did that with my niece recently, because I was trying to tell her about saving money. And I was like, just because you have a hammer doesn't mean you go banging holes in the walls all over the house. So you don't spend your money just like crazy. It's not working.
Did you go through that?
Money?
Yeah. Did you get into money and spending money?
No.
Going nuts with money?
Maybe now. I mean, no, I never did. I never wanted for money. I mean, I wanted for money when I was really had nothing.
Yeah.
in the sense that I really wasn't living on anything, and that happened a couple times in my life. But I, you know, it's not like I need to make more money because I have a big overhead and I have to send the kids to college. And no, I really didn't have. I don't really think I have a thing with that. I'm pretty lucky that way so far.
So far, I like. There's always a possibility.
Thank you.
Sure, since you said so far. Are you feeling like this is like a transition time for you? Are you feeling like you're in the like the middle of something?
Well, I just started writing a book. So in that sense, I started sort of thinking to myself, what does that mean for me? Because it's fun and it's one of the things I kind of, not to write a book, but just to write, I always sort of thought would be good for me and I would like that. And I have a gig in 2 weeks and I got to get myself together and stop, you know, pondering on this project, which is totally different, you know. And
what's the book?
It's a memoir, go figure, about my time in Paris, playing on the street. Basically this interview, transcribed.
You're welcome to it. So what are you thinking about while you're here?
Well, I've been visiting my mom, and the hardest part has been trying to conceptualize her experience as a mother. You know, with me going out, leaving home, first running away from school, doing all these crazy things, and then suddenly, like, she would go down to the Latin Quarter to find me, and she'd hear me singing from down the block.
Did you know that you were coming back to feel that, or did you think you were coming back to get in touch with what you were feeling, and as you've been here visiting your mother, you've gotten in touch with what you think she might have been going through?
I just planned to come here way before the book even happened. I just planned to visit with her. And then the book started to come up, this meeting came together and I started writing, and that's a big part of the book that was just like, oh my God, how do I talk about my mother? How did she do it? And why don't I just start off by saying I was terrible, because it's the only explanation I have. But yeah, I think that's a big question mark, figuring out how to deal with, you know, rebellion. And in a way, I think it can translate into music too. Like you say to yourself, well, these are my heroes musically. Now learn all of this and now forget it all. Mm-hmm. And you do that all the time when you're playing music, especially if you're going to try to, I don't know, improvise or just take a leap of faith in performance.
And I think what you have to reconcile is the fact that through all of that rebellion and all of that hell that you put your mother through, your career and your artist life was born and emerged.
Yeah. I don't know how much of all of that really matters. I think any artist has a weird or troubled relationship with their parents, don't you? I mean, don't. If you look back, maybe historically, did you ever see the film of when Marlon Brando appeared on television with his father and mother, and he was already kind of a movie star, but still within like maybe after the first couple of big movies, and his father's like, they're like, what do you think about your son? He's like, oh, I wish he'd get a real job. Like, on national television? Really?
And humiliated.
Yeah, humiliated. Why did I bring that up?
Because all artists have a strained relationship with their parents.
Yeah, I think on some level you're facing rebellion because it's the natural course of growing up and self, you know, identifying, and sort of like an essential evil or something in a way. But my mom is really, really a cool person in the sense that she does intellect, she grasps all of that stuff and did back then. And that's kind of maybe the challenge for me, is to say, what kind of a mom could understand that? And isn't that a bad mom? It's kind of a lot to take on, especially because I'm not a mom. So I have to figure this stuff out if I'm going to talk about it, really. Okay, let's talk about music.
No. I want to talk about this. I never went through that. I never allowed myself to go through that, and I think it hindered me artistically.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I think that when you say it's a necessary evil. It's a rite of passage. You just do it. And so for your mother to look at you and say, this is what I think she's going through, and as hard as this is as a mother. I'm a father. I can't imagine my daughter.
Right.
I can't imagine.
No.
And then being like, either cool enough or...
Don't let her do it.
Why not, though? As you said, it's a necessary evil.
No, this is a cautionary tale.
You're a cautionary tale?
I am a cautionary tale. I tell you, I went crazy. I went in the mental hospital. I wasn't happy. And then all of a sudden, this guy who nobody really cares what he does says, let's make a record. Who cares? It just went. It just went forward, you know, like the wheels of time. It just goes
so
forward.
What is the road not taken, then? If your tale is the cautionary tale, where was the fork in the road and what road did you not take? What did you not do?
I don't know. I mean, I did think, because my parents were teachers, I thought I would go to college. But, you know, there wasn't anything else in my mind. I when I was 8, I would be like, I'm going to college, and then I'm going... Mm-hmm. Oh,
that was
know.
It. That was where it stopped.
Yeah, I'm definitely going to go to college, maybe get a PhD. Well, what happens after that? You become a teacher.
Mm-hmm.
So I would have to think that way. I don't know. They were academics, and so I just, you know, I had no idea. I don't know. I never knew what I was going to do. Even when I thought I knew what I was going to do at the age of about 14, I remember my French math teacher asked me, what are you planning on doing? And I was like, well, I want to study French literature from the 18th century. And I remember her going, really? How did you know you want that? And it wasn't until a couple of years later, I said, so, Mom, what was really your thing? She was like, oh, French literature from the 18th century. So I was just, like, saying...
What you heard.
Whatever. Yeah, just imitating stuff, which, of course, explains my whole career, right? Just being able to say what I heard.
Wait. Do go back into that for a minute. What do you mean?
Oh, you know what I mean. It's...
What, to sound like your influences? Is that what you mean?
No, to imitate.
To imitate.
Isn't imitation, I mean, yeah, to imitate first. And like what you were saying about being able to rebel against your parents, I mean, I'll tell you, my father, as much as I tried to rebel against him, he was such a rebellious guy, I couldn't. So I always felt like I had not, I mean, till the day he died now. I mean, I feel like, you know, there was no... Yeah, maybe posthumously I could say a lot of things. But doing that directly with him never worked.
You failed at rebelling against your father.
Oh, yeah, because you can't get more rebellious than him. You cannot shock... You couldn't have shocked him, you know, at all. Because he was just like, yeah, well, let me show you this.
Right. You check this out.
Oh, yeah, you think that's something, huh? So in a way, my mother is the reason that I have what I have.
It's interesting that you say that isn't that my career, imitating? Because, you know...
Well, yeah, that's going to open up the Billie Holiday sound.
Yes, I suppose it is. Although...
It's not the only thing.
What, again, over and over again, I don't hear you saying, like, I was 7 years old and I was struck by lightning when I heard a Billie Holiday record at all.
Right, right.
And I bet that it just so happened that when you heard... You said it. When I heard Billie, I was like, I know what that is.
Yeah.
It wasn't so much like aping a thing. It was like, I know what that is.
Well,
which
that
is
so nice to hear somebody say. It really makes a difference. And you really sound very articulate.
Put it on the back of your book.
I know what that is. Oh, I totally want to use that, but I won't because you said it first.
Well, I see. I think you have your influences, and you try to sound like them, and you never will be them. And in failing to sound like someone else, that is where you will become yourself. The failure is where you find yourself. You're kind of fucked if you really succeed.
Yeah.
Because then you don't know who you are. It's in not being able to live up to that thing that you find your own voice.
Yeah.
But
I couldn't agree with you more. And you've taken it to another level. It's not just in the practice of of the experience of hearing what comes out of you when you're playing in one way or another. But it's in your whole essence and your whole self-identity. Do I feel this way? Who am I? Am I failing at being that thing? And yeah, great. Great. It's very reliable to be unsatisfied. Isn't there a saying? Larry Klein wrote me this in an email. He was like, keep up the eternal... Eternal dissatisfaction. Just always be dissatisfied with everything.
Yeah, it works. It seems like you have a serious, ongoing relationship with Larry.
Yeah.
And that he has helped to define the sound and the approach. What's it like to have a producer like that?
Sometimes it's a little too comfortable, I think. I think that's why I tried working with somebody else.
You did one record with Craig Street, right?
I did. I tried working with somebody else, and Craig Street was around, and he and I had talked before, and, you know, we had a lot of discussions about what it could be, and then all of a sudden there we were. And, you know, this is another part of that whole idea of what is your job as a singer, you know, and I think collaborating, obviously, is the key to doing a good job in the end, no matter what, at least for me, rather. And I think with Larry, there's a lot of, like, automatic understanding between us. Just sort of like, I already know.
Because you've been through it, or you felt that was there already?
Both. Making Careless Love with him was funny, because at first it was all like, oh, it feels new. You know, I had a conversation with him on the phone before we agreed to work together, where I said, well, what kind of record do you want to make? And he's like, well... I don't want to make a record. I want to make a dream of a record. I don't know if I'm verbatim quoting him, but it's definitely like, I don't want to make that, but I want to make a dream of that. And that's it. That's like kind of...
Did you know... Did you feel like you knew what he was saying?
No. No, I definitely did not. No. But once we started actually sitting down and playing songs together, it was so easy. It was like, oh, I love that song. Those lyrics are great. Yes. And that could kind of go this direction. We can play with it in that direction. And I was like, yeah, I got it.
What did you come in with, and what did he come in with? Did he come in with songs?
Yeah, he gave me a whole book of Leonard Cohen lyrics, and he said, go learn all of these songs. And, you know, I just kept picking songs out and trying them out until we settled on Dance Me to the End of Love, and then I did that. But most of the songs on that first record I was working on and had been working on for a while.
I mean, Leonard Cohen is so interesting. Having spent time over here, you know, he looms so large in Europe, and he's such a big influence here. And actually coming up in the States, like, he didn't register on my radar for a long time. And then over time, you realize he's, like, influenced so many people. And actually, his songs are beautiful vehicles for singers, but it's very hard to hear into them sometimes when he's delivering them.
That's the dream for a singer. He's a great songwriter that can't sing so well.
Dylan.
So Dylan's difficult because he's got, like I said, he's got this power delivery. And it's like, how do you come back from that?
Yeah.
But some people have been able to do it. And I think even Leonard Cohen is difficult because his lyrics are so introspective. There's tons of songs that I've just tried to pick up, and there's too much going on. Randy Newman, same thing. Like, there's just all this irony, and you've got to really be able to, like, have that character. And, you know, you've got a middle-aged guy saying one thing, and then a sort of naive-sounding voice of a woman saying the same thing, and it's like, you know, boom goes London. I mean, how does that work? Boom, parry, you know, more room for you, more room for me. I always wanted to do that one, but it just doesn't work the same way.
Like, right.
Yeah, a woman's dropping the bomb?
Yeah.
No, it doesn't. No, we can't.
But, maybe you can.
These are all difficult things. And then the idea that men write all the songs, too, that's another problem in and of itself.
Well, so then you started writing.
Yeah, and I always wanted to, and we'll see if that can continue. I've been writing recently.
Well,
you know?
Yes. Tell me.
Where are we at right now?
I think
we're only on the second round. How much more you?
You want to do one more round? Should we do one more?
Well, we're in Paris, right?
Let's do one more. Dude, should we go in? Is it getting too cold? Are you
okay?
It is cold.
We can move in if you like.
Let's go in.
Okay.
And should I move us in? So you were talking about relationship with Larry. Not too comfortable, but like, that it's comfortable and you challenge yourself to kind of...
Right. Well, I know that, it did get to a point after we made 3 records together. After Bare Bones, I thought, okay... I want to try something else. It feels too comfortable. So, it's sort of a gradual thing. But that doesn't really take away from the relationship that we have and how nurturing that is. But I think on some level, I just thought it would be interesting to be able to explore stuff. I started to have that desire. Like we were talking about earlier, did you have a goal, what your sound would be, and all these kind of things? And for most of my life, I don't, but...
Did you feel that he helped you to define what the sound of the music was?
Yeah, I think... I do. I think that the first record that I made was sort of a mosh-posh of different sounds, and didn't sound like a record, right?
The Atlantic record.
Right, and it was pretty mixed up.
Maybe because you could go in so many different directions that it was hard to figure out how to hone it in.
Well, I think rather at the opposite. At that time, it was that I really was very comfortable with the original arrangements of old songs, and the producer's job was, because there were two producers, it was Greg Cohen and Yves Beauvais, and the goal was to break the arrangements out of the old sound so that my sound would be contrasted by a more modern take on old songs. That was kind of the goal. That's definitely what Yves Beauvais told me we were trying to do. And, of course, I was just at a point where I was like, man, everything sounds new and weird to me. I don't care what we do. Just try and make it good, but... and with those musicians,
because
it was like whatever.
You didn't
like,
have
great.
A huge concept of what making a record was at that point. You had a sense of what it was to sing live, but not necessarily what it meant to make a record.
Yeah, absolutely. Even just to record a song and say, this is a new rendition of this song was, enough in itself. But what are we trying to do? And can you make a whole record sound? And even years later, like when I finally met with Larry and he was like, yeah, that record sounded kind of all over the place, and I was like, okay, we have to grasp the fact that this is not just, there's so many different definitions of a record, right? Is this sort of a, Eve used to say that it was like a documentation of where you were at that time in your life, but I don't think that's fair either, because I think, a lot of the greatest records of all time are accumulation of somebody's desires for their whole life.
Yeah.
I think.
That's wonderful. I know what Eve is saying, because I think that to a certain degree you have to allow that a record is going to capture a moment in time, right? No matter what moment it's capturing, it is capturing a moment in time. But I also agree with you that at any moment we can channel all of our desires and all of who we are. And also you said something earlier about whether or not you think your records stand on their own. Like you said at one point, if I believed that I had made a single record that could stand on its own, I would never have to sing another gig. Which means that you're kind of aspiring to that, right? To be able to make a record that really is not just capturing a moment in time, but is this totally timeless piece of art that doesn't have to be explained by its time.
And I think that's a painful thing to do, and you have to really believe in it to be willing to let go, right? Because you're in a way letting go of the ability to come back to that question and give a different answer.
It's hard though, because if you think about Kind of Blue, Love Supreme, Sgt. Pepper's, these are all records that are totally of their moment, but that are also completely stand up alone, and I feel like exist as these perfect things. But I have to say, I think I think those records that you made with Larry are there. I mean, I really do. And I remember when you and I worked in the studio together, even just on that kids record, how enormously ever-present those records were in my head. Just knowing how great the records are that you've made, you know what I mean?
You mean it was good, it was a good thing you had heard me do a record by that point when I got in the studio?
No.
Kids Song was fun, by the way.
It was super fun. It's not that it was a good thing I had heard you make a record. It was more that I was aware that I thought every record that I had ever heard you make, and I admit I had not heard the Atlantic record at that point, was like a perfectly crafted thing. You know, it seemed like it was a closed circuit, you know?
Well, we really have to thank Larry for that in a lot of ways. He blew my mind a few times. Like, for example, I remember that there was a quota of songs, right, that we had agreed to, at least with the label. And we'd only recorded 11 in the studio, basic tracks. And I was like, so...
This is the first record?
Yeah, this is with Larry, Careless Love. And he said, come in. He would just have me hanging out in Los Angeles because he has his own little studio where I do all my vocals, and we would just hang out. We would take a lot of time, like 2 weeks or something, me just singing, go home, come back. And he would do a lot of comping to this very day. I mean, there's nobody that can comp vocals like that, although I hope there is. But anyway, so I remember him saying, come back into the studio. I want you to check something out. And I came in, and he had, like, created this track. He knew a song that I could sing, but we hadn't tracked it. And he had built up this thing from some samples, which was, like, a hypnotic intro, which is This Has Happened to Me on the Careless Love records, the last one. And it starts off with these sort of, those glass harmonica sound that he took from a soundtrack to a Fellini movie. And it didn't. It's just you can't really source it.
Right. He looped it in some way.
He looped a certain pattern, and there we had our 12th song, and it was just surprises. You know, it is a weird record. I mean, I look back. If I actually listened to all of Careless Love again, I would say, okay, that doesn't really make sense, but. Yeah, okay, if you want to say that, okay, fine. You know? But as opposed to saying, like, that's exactly what needs to be said now. And maybe that's the problem with records and even with art in general. It's like, you know, when you get to the point where, like, well, how is this ever going to be timeless if you're doing it in the moment? And it has to be meaningful now. How is it going to be meaningful? How is everything? Nothing can be meaningful forever. So you have to have at least a certain amount of patience for the fact that that's why academics can always say, oh, this is great, this is interesting, because, you know,
in its context,
because you study the whole context, and the more context there is, the more academic the artwork is, and the less accessible and the more elitist it becomes. And it's just like, you know, something that could have been completely innocent and in the moment can become this stupid, like, study of detail that's irrelevant. So I'm not really giving you anything.
No, it's unbelievable, because think about this. You are saying this. Your style is heavily rooted in music that was certainly on that record. I mean, that was what was happening, is that you had sort of like a very 30s approach or 40s approach, but sonically it sounded very contemporary, right? Like, it sounded new and it sounded old at the same time. And so it was an exercise in context.
Yeah.
Playing with context.
Yeah,
I guess that's
absolutely
what you're saying. How can it be timeless if it's just a game of juxtaposing context?
Right.
But it ends up sounding timeless also. Both are true.
Yeah, being willing to strip the context away on the one hand, and on the other hand, to be willing to invite all of the modern context into something.
One shorthand that a lot of people use is something that sounds filtered and through a telephone and sounds like it's from a radio remixed with beats. You know, that would be like a very shorthand to say new and old.
What I would call, like, bad mixed with beats. Bad quality sound mixed with beats.
Right.
It's like, why is bad quality? And by the way, why did jazz records have to be so bright and loud?
You feel this? You feeling this, that they're riding, right? But okay, so I'm glad that you bring this up, though, because your records,
like sharps, like making the horn sound, saxophone sound like really nasal.
But who decided that your vocals could be dry? I mean, what did you feel the first time you heard a mix of your record and it was like, there's no reverb on my voice?
Yeah, that's from my first record with Eve. I was like, you know, we would try stuff and everything sounded a little bit synthetic. And I don't know if he even had, like, I mean, Larry puts a plate reverb on there, you know. It's not like it's bone dry, really. But somehow Larry, and by the way, not for nothing, the engineer, Helik Hadar, both during tracking and mixing, because he did both for all of those records together, I, you know, there's a lot of magic involved in how he was capable of doing things, close miking everything, and still being able to set my voice right
in
up in a center like that, so that, you know, not just so that you can hear details, but that so you can actually sort of appreciate them a little bit. That's definitely a mixed thing. So that's a dream come true for a singer. I mean, you can't walk away from that ever.
This idea of you sort of living near Larry and or in the studio and being available to sort of sing a lot and get into the music, and I think it seems like it was a real important part of the process when you worked on those records with Larry.
Absolutely, yeah. There's no distance, really. There's no room for being... there's no going home, you know. You don't go home.
Yeah.
You know? Which is good. It's good. That works for me.
Some people, I think, like to go home at the end of the day. And then other people treat making a record as a kind of an excursion, you know. And you live in the record, and you swim in it, and you bathe in it, and you eat it.
Get it over with, man.
And you do it.
You know, don't ever go back. Don't ever look back. You know, that's the thing. Because I couldn't stand that. That's just torture. Like, oh, I should have, could have. No, just do
it. You did it. But that's where I think this Eve Beauvais concept of, like, you are capturing a moment one way or the other.
Yeah.
You are living in it. I mean, you know.
Yeah, but on a certain level, that's just a scientific explanation for what's happening. And it's not at all, and that's why I'm not surprised that it's Eve saying that, because he lives the experience as a producer and an A&R guy first, and sort of just an all-around music man back in the day. I mean, he lives all that very deeply. Everything except the one experience of actually doing it. And I think that the person that's doing it doesn't think of it as a document. It's not a document at all. It can't be, because if it's just a document, then it's not art. You're not performing if you're just documenting something. Like, okay, there was a plane crash this week, right? That's a document. A song about a plane crash, if it's done right, it's timeless. It's about every plane crash that ever happened, right? I mean, that's the only way that it's real.
My heart broke this week. It's a document.
Yeah.
I write a song about it. It's about every heart that ever broke.
Exactly. And for whatever reason, too. It doesn't even have to be the same
problem. Same reason. No, of course. Of course.
It could be anything. Talking about breaking up with somebody, and whereas it could be about your abusive... I mean, whatever. It could be anything. Anyway, that's what I like about music.
You were never in the music school scene. You were never hanging out with a bunch of
aspiring
whatevers. You know, you just kind of, it sort of just happened on your own terms, in your own time, in your way, the way it had to unfold for you.
That's right.
But I wonder if you feel a certain distance, isolation from other people of your generation who did come up trying to aspire to be something.
Yeah, sure. I'm still the nerd.
Wait, why are you the nerd?
Well, I mean, that's who I was, you know.
You're the nerd from before...
From before the GED, from before high school, yeah. I had a horrible time. Horrible.
I just think it's so interesting that you're still thinking about being self-taught and all of these things, and yet you have been able to connect with an audience on a level that so many people with way more education and with way more sort of like aspiration have not been able to connect. That it's
maybe. I mean, don't you think that those are very separate issues? And, I mean, there's so many different things we could say about that. One of them is that school doesn't teach you how to connect with an audience. It teaches you everything but, and then it says, go ahead, go out there and see what you can do. And it's sort of like, right, like, in order to write a book, learn to read. It's, like, not going to happen directly out of school. It's a totally different study. And yet, is it possible to teach that or not? Can you teach art? That's like an eternal question. But I mean, I think, yeah, of course you can. But it has to be like a language, total immersion. Go live there. Like you would say to somebody, you know, just because you have a foreign girlfriend and you learn the language from her.
You'll only ever be a copy until you embrace who you are.
Yeah. Well, you know, if you're so lucky that you can really stay away from being marginalized in any way, from being put in a category musically, then you got it made, you know?
Is that you?
Me? No, not at all, in fact. That's the thing. I think that's my biggest... That's a big struggle.
What category are you in?
Blues. I'm happy to be in... I'll settle with the blues.
When you started writing, you started doing a lot of co-writing.
Yeah, in order to finish a song.
Tell me about that.
Maybe it's backwards because I'm a singer. I go at it from the opposite end of the stick, which is to say, okay, this is what the song's going to be about.
Mm-hmm.
And this is all the story that has to get across in the time allotted and within those lyrics. If I write lyrics, I can, you know, I have the advantage of saying to myself, well, this I can sing. This I can sing. This I can't sing. This,
meaning melodically or just lyrically, I can pull this off. I can own this.
I haven't written, you know, I've noticed I don't write difficult melodies. I just write melodies that kind of go along with the sound of a monologue, of the way you would say something out loud.
But that's how a Leonard Cohen melody is anyway.
Yeah, sure. And he made it work. Most people don't make it work. But I have the advantage of saying, well, I'm going to try to sing this. And if I can get the emotion across with this lyric, with my voice, I know this, I can try to do it. So that's good, because the more boundaries you have within what you're doing, right, the better you get. Quicker you get there, but...
That's deep. A lot of people don't understand that. Setting those... Some kind of confinement is actually a very creative thing to do.
It really is, yeah. And of course, the problem is choosing which one you want, because, you know, there's a millions of them. I mean, it's like probably everything that could be created has been created, right? So we're just gonna say okay now. Like, I love writing for example exercises, like trying to write a poem where every line starts with somebody's with the next letter of somebody's name, you know, one of those things. And then you've got all kinds of rules within that, like there's got to be a certain amount of meter, and then do you want it to rhyme, and what's the rhyme scheme going to be, and how does that affect the meaning? And
have you ever been in a song club of any kind, or is it
no? I'd like to try it someday.
Me too.
I don't think I have I don't think I had the head for it.
But okay, so let's take a song like I've Been Lonely Before.
It's Larry Klein and Walter Becker.
Oh, and Walter Becker.
Yeah, that's a funny one. I sent them the music by email, even though I was right there in Los Angeles. Sent them an email of the music, the melody, and a few rough ideas with a chorus, it's all right, it's all right. And they sent me back the lyrics. Done.
So you had It's All Right, It's All Right. Did you say I've Been Lonely Before?
No.
It's All Right, It's All Right.
I don't know what I said, yeah. No, they had the most important part. The lyrics made sense.
But what's so funny to me about that lyric is that not only does it sound good...
It's two old guys writing a lyric for a young girl in the first person. Perfect. I figure all you gotta do is say, well... Young women do that all the time. I certainly have, trying to see what an older man's point of view is. And now it's finally come around full circle. But I've tried to put myself in the headspace of an older man several times singing songs, is what I'm saying. And they finally wrote a song So, you know, it kind of was like the world was in perfect balance.
Interesting. So it felt like a comfortable lyric to sing because you felt like you appreciated
It's a good lyric, yeah. Oh, I've had to sing so many uncomfortable lyrics. That was like one of the best.
Like what?
Like a sweet young thing from the 30s, Ziegfeld Follies. So degrading. Thought I'd step out one night. I longed to get the thrill in life I'd missed. I met a youth, a bit uncouth, although he seemed all right. I knew him from the moment that we kissed. Then I got home next day with a swollen head. Mm. My girlfriend asked if I had fun. I said, was I drunk? Was he handsome? And did Mama give me hell? Oh, I hated that song. I hated it. But I recorded it eventually because everybody likes it.
Are there any contemporary writers that you respond to that you think... I wish I could find a way, or I'd like to find a way to sing a song by that person, or to go lyrically.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Do you listen to music?
I do, but in spurts. I spend periods of time not listening to music at all.
I would say everybody I've talked to tells me that they struggle with listening to music.
Yeah.
It becomes the hardest thing.
Yeah.
And me too.
Yeah.
It becomes almost...
There are some musicians that listen to music after gigs. After we play, get on the bus or something, or in the hotel room. He's like, check out my speakers. But it's an excuse to, like, just listen to some shit that we all know, he knows is going to be good.
Yeah.
And it's actually really, really soothing to do it that way. And that's kind of the natural way to listen to music, which I don't think we do, because I'm not forced into going, what did he play? Oh, how did they go there? Oh, no, just fucking drink your beer, you know.
What I think is hard is sitting at home.
Oh, God.
Looking for new music.
Oh, my God. Because, well, basically, you spend most of your time suffering through bad music and skipping ahead.
And
I spend a lot of time on YouTube.
Looking at what?
Whatever. Well, actually, classical music, to be honest. So I'm going way back because I just never really had that education, and I just... Sometimes I start to, like, really get to listen to it for the first time, whereas that's not something I think works in group listening for some reason. I don't know.
That's really interesting.
Not for me. My dad used to play Ravel's Bolero over and over. He also used to play Lieutenant Kijev by, what's his name, the Russian? Oh, God, I forgot his name. Well, it's my fourth beer, so anyway.
Let me say this.
Yes, talk.
Before I forget, we need to say this now. You ready?
Yeah.
Madeleine, thank you so much for giving this conversation. It's been such a pleasure.
Thanks for coming all the way to Paris, Leo.
It was long, but worth it.
Yeah, I'll see you back in the neighborhood.
Got it.